If you have your Bible with you, open up with me to Proverbs chapter 4. I believe Pastor Nate was in Proverbs chapter 11, but Proverbs chapter 4, basically it's right smack dab in the middle of your Bible. Wow, I'm saying silly words tonight. It's right in the middle of your Bible. Also, when you use your paper Bible, it helps you to know where stuff is in it. So when you know, somebody's up here and says, turn to such and such scripture, it's easy for you. And if you know the books of the Bible, where they're at, it's easy for you to find scripture. When God speaks a scripture to your heart, it's easier for you to find it. And I know a lot of us are used to, you know, the tap and scroll down to the book you want. But I encourage you, get out your Bible. All right, Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 23 says, keep your heart with all diligence. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it springs the issues of life. What that means is out of your heart comes all everything else that you do. So the Bible says keep your heart, or guard your heart, protect your heart against what the devil would try and steal from you. So tonight we're talking on the subject of living pure in a sexually driven world. Living pure in a sexually driven world. How many know we live in a very sexual world? If you've walked down the street and seen a billboard, you have probably realized that our world is very sexually driven. And so what we're talking about tonight is how we can stay pure the way God has called us to in the world that we live in. Because guess what? God placed you here this hour, this time, with your family on this planet in Oregon on purpose for a reason, and that's so that you can be who God has called you to be. You may say, well, it'd be so much easier if I lived back in the 1920s. Things weren't as hard for the teenagers back then. Wrong. God placed you here because he knew that you could do what he's called you to do. So don't be wishing you were living in a different time. Don't be wishing you were living 100 years from now. No, believe that God has chosen you to live right now in this moment and do all that you can do to live it for God. All right, every eye closed, every head bowed, let's pray. Father, we thank you for your sweet presence. We love to worship you. We love to be in your presence. And Father, I ask right now that every word that I speak would be something that you could use to help these students understand what you're saying, that we would learn how we can truly live pure in this crazy world that we live in. Holy Spirit, we give you free rein to minister, to speak, to help us understand from your word. Bring us revelation, Father. We want more of you. We are hungry for you, God. We're not satisfied with where we've been. We want to go up another level. We want to go higher from glory to glory. And we thank you, Father, you're taking us there tonight. Amen? In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so I want to play a game, actually. Has anybody ever played Heads Up, Seven Up? Yes, yes. Okay, so everybody, heads down in your lap. Okay, so it's not totally like Heads Up, Seven Up, but I want you to put your hand up, okay? And I'm gonna ask questions, I'm gonna ask questions, okay? And when it applies to you, I want you to kind of like wave your hand even more so. Here. Wave your hand even more so, okay? So you can put your hand up, because then your neighbor won't know if you actually like lift your hand. Because, close your eyes, heads down, heads completely down, every eye closed. Come on, heads up, seven up, ready? Parents two, everybody's eyes down. Okay, first one, have you ever had a crush? If you've ever had a crush on somebody, wave your hand. Okay, I see hands waving. Have you ever had a girlfriend or a boyfriend? Hands waving. Have you ever seen pornography? Hands waving. Have you ever watched a sex scene in a movie? Okay, hands waving. Remember, nobody's looking. Keep your eyes down. I want you to be honest. Do you want to be a virgin when you get married? Everybody's hands should be waving. Do you want to be a virgin when you get married? Do you want to save yourself from marriage for your husband? Sexually, purely, saving yourself. Yes. All right, heads up, seven up. Not really, but kind of. Okay, I didn't tell anybody your answers. Nobody saw what you said. But the truth is a lot of us have come across some sort of pornography, or seen naked people on TV, or seen something that we shouldn't see and that we know we shouldn't see, or had even as something as little as like had a crush on somebody, right? We've all experienced different things in our sexuality. And that's part of it. Some of you guys are really young and your bodies are changing and stuff is happening and you're trying to figure this all out and you're being thrown at, media is throwing stuff at you and you're trying to figure out what it all means. Like, you're trying your best to be pure and do what God's called you to do. But sometimes the truth is it can be hard to stay pure in the world that we live in because of all the things that are around us. There's so much around us bombarding us. If you go to public school, you've probably heard a thing or two. You've probably heard some bad words. You've probably heard some dirty jokes. You've probably seen, you know, a guy and girl making out, right? Yeah, and it is disgusting. It's gross. But the truth is you've probably been exposed to some sort of sexuality in your life. And what we want to do as the church, and hopefully your parents coming alongside of you, is to help you stay pure in the midst of all the junk. And you might say, well, is that possible? Yes, it is possible. It's possible for you to keep yourself for your spouse, to save yourself for your spouse, to not have sex with anyone else except for the one person that you married. It is possible. And even though you may think, well, everybody at school is talking about it, and who knows what they're doing, or they say they're doing it, or maybe they're not. I don't really know. It doesn't really matter what anybody else is doing. What matters is what you do. Say that with me. It matters what I do. So I want to go to a scripture, Psalms 119. So you can, it's right before Proverbs if you want to flip over there. Psalms 119, it's the longest chapter in the Bible. And I love it because it's so clear. Psalms 119 and verse 9, and I'm going to read this out of the NLT. It says, how can a young person stay pure? Any young people in the house? Yeah, that's all of you. I'm even raising my hand because I'm young too. Yes. How can a young person stay pure? The Bible's asking this. How can a young person stay pure? Is it possible in this crazy world that we live in for a young person to stay pure? Here is how it's possible. Okay, it gives us the answer right here. The next line, by obeying your word. By obeying God's word. The Passion Translation says it like this: only by living in the word of God and walking in its truth. Young person, you can stay pure in this sexually driven world by living according to God's word and obeying his truths. And as you read your Bible, if you live according to the word, that's how you can stay pure. In verse 11, it goes on to say, I've hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Anybody ever heard that scripture before? I hope so. Or underline it. If you haven't, go to it, underline it. That's how we keep our heart pure towards God. We hide God's word in our heart. What does that mean? I memorize scripture. I read the Bible and I get it into my heart. And that's how we keep from sinning against God. Sin is anything that grieves God. Sin is wrongdoing that when we know to do something and we don't do it, then that's sin. So if you know you're supposed to obey your parents and not slam your door and say, I hate you, then if you slam your door shut and you say, I hate you, and you scream at your parents and flip them off behind the door, then what is that? Sin. That's sin. Okay? If you know you're not supposed to cuss and you cuss, then that's sin. If you know you're not supposed to watch a certain show and you do it anyway, then that's sin. So anything that we do, knowing we're not supposed to do it, then that's sin. And the Bible says how we keep away from sinning is by hiding God's word in our heart, applying it to our lives, memorizing scripture, getting it on the inside of us. I wanted to give you some other scriptures. You don't have to turn there, but I just wanted to read these because sometimes I think that we come to church and we hear, oh yeah, I'm not supposed to have sex till I'm married, or I'm not supposed to watch pornography, or, you know, like, I'm supposed to do all these things, but you're not really sure what the Bible says about it. I've heard, you know, Pastor Nate say, or I've heard Hannah say, or I've heard somebody preach about, and really that's not good enough. You have to know what the Bible says. So I just want to read what the Bible says concerning sexual purity. These are just a few scriptures. There's a lot more. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, in verse 3, it says, finally, dear brothers and sisters, or teenagers, we urge you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to live in a way that pleases God, as we've taught you. God's will is for you to be holy, so stay away from all sexual sin. This is in the Bible. This is New Testament. God's will is for you to be holy, so stay away from all sexual sin. Then each of you will control his own body and live in holiness and honor. Say, I will control my own body. Did you know you can control yourself? You can. You can control yourself. The Passion Translation says it like this, says, yes, each of you must guard your sexual purity with holiness and dignity. Young people, that is your job as a young person, is to guard your sexual purity and don't let anyone steal it from you. And how you do that, we're going to talk about some really super practical ways tonight that you can do that. Hebrews 13:4 says, honor marriage and guard the sacredness of sexual intimacy between a husband and a wife, meaning only have sex when you're married. 1 Corinthians 7:2 says, first, is it good to have sexual relations? So is sex good? Yes. Verse 2 says, certainly, but only within a certain context. Remember a couple weeks ago, Pastor Nate preached and he had, who ate the gross, disgusting stuff? What was it? Ice cream and hot sauce? Barbecue sauce and ice cream? Orange juice and mouthwash. Okay, so mouthwash is good. It feels good when you wash your mouth, but drinking orange juice right after is nasty, right? So in the wrong context, meaning outside of marriage, sex is wrong. But in marriage, sex is good. And sometimes we hear that, we get this drummed into us, sex is bad, sex is bad, don't have sex, die, curse, curse, like sex, no. And we grow up thinking sex is this horrible thing because our parents don't want us to do it and we don't really know what it is, but And the truth is that sex is actually God-ordained sex and it is good and holy, but only in the confines of marriage, not with anybody else's spouse, not with anybody else except for the person that you're married to. Okay, so that's what the Bible says about sexual purity. So can we agree that according to the Word of God, God wants us to stay pure? Yes. Okay, so those are just a few scriptures. So here we're going to go away some practical things that you can do. So, you know, how many of y'all have feelings? How many of y'all felt happy today, sad today, kind of crazy today? Maybe your emotions are up and down. We all have emotions, and if we live according to our emotions, we'd all be all sorts of crazy. When you get hurt, you cry. When you know, like, if it's a good day, if your teacher was nice to you, then you're happy. If your parents yelled at you in the morning, then you're sad, right? And so we sometimes our emotions, as teenagers especially, because our emotions tend to be all sorts of crazy. Our hormones are changing. You know, things are happening, and we're like, I don't know why I'm crying. It's okay. You'll live through it. There'll be a day, well, maybe, when you don't have to cry and know why you're crying. But the truth is that you can control your emotions, but your emotions can be super fickle. Just like we were talking about earlier, you can't really control a lot of things in this world. You can't control who goes to high school with you. You have no control over that. You have no control over what people around you say. If somebody is telling a dirty joke, you have no control over their mouth and what they're saying. You have no control over when you're on Instagram and an ad pops up. You have no control over what kind of movies they're making or what the latest song is. You have no control over the cool song that just came out. You have no control over the coolest new meme that you just saw. You have no control over those things. Am I right? Am I right? Okay, but I'm going to tell you what you do have control over. You have control over you. So everything that pertains to you and your body and your life, you have control over it. And so we're going to talk about some things that we have control over. So number one, I hope you're taking notes tonight. Number one, eyes. You have control over your eyes. Okay, I need a volunteer. Run up here, somebody. All right, JJ, put these on. All right, JJ, and they say, well, walk by faith and not by sight, because that's the scripture. All right, so JJ, he has control over his eyes, over the things that he looks at. Okay, you can just look at the people and smile. Okay, so Matthew chapter 5 in verse 27, it says, stay right there, don't leave. It says, your ancestors have taught you never commit adultery. That means don't have sexual relations with someone you're not married to, or don't go to bed with another person's spouse. Okay, it says, however, I say to you, if you look with lust, okay, so that's the old law in the Old Testament. But Jesus is saying, if you look with lust in your eyes at the body of a woman who is not your wife, or a man who is not your husband, you've already committed adultery with her in your heart. Okay, so what does that mean? If you look with lust, that's the same as doing something inappropriately with your body. This is what Jesus is saying. If you look at somebody lustfully and wanting something from them that is not holy and pure outside of a marriage bed, then that is sin. Okay, so your eyes. Do you have control over your eyes and where they look? Yes, you do. You do. Okay, so then it goes on to say this. If your right eye causes you to sin, then go blind in your right eye. Cut it out. For it'd be better off losing sight in one eye than to have your whole body thrown into hell. Ah, you're like, what? Like, seriously? Jesus wants me to cut out my eye? No, he's saying the severity of this. What we look at is super important. He's saying if your eyes cause you to sin, if your eyes cause you to lust, you'd be better off being blind than to go to hell. Because purity is a big deal to God. Thank you, JJ. I'll take those back. Purity is a big deal to God. It matters the things that you look at. So when that thing pops up on your Instagram feed, or when that half-naked guy in the swimming pool pops up on your picture and you're like, oh, you have a choice whether you're gonna click on it and scroll through more pictures or whether you're gonna keep going. Or guys, when a lady pops up and, you know, she doesn't have very much clothes on and you can see things that you shouldn't be seeing. Guys, I heard the statistic that 8-year-olds are beginning, that's the age of the average person sees pornography for the first time. 8 years old. So you are not too young for us to be talking to you about this. Chances are very high that you've probably seen some sort of pornography. That means people that are naked and doing things that they should not be doing in a sexual way. And it is sin to God. It is sin to look at those things. And boys especially, let me talk to you. If you're looking at those things, you are defiling your own heart. That means you are choosing your own lusts over what the Bible says. And I'm telling you tonight, you have a choice of what you look at. And I've known adults who struggle with this because at a young age, they started looking at things they shouldn't have been looking at, and the devil got a hold of them, and they were addicted to looking at negative things, and it had a hold on their life. And I'm telling you guys, the sexual arena, the devil really loves to entangle young people in the sexual arena because he loves to ruin young people's lives. And if you're smart, you'll pay attention to what the Holy Spirit is saying on the inside of you, and you'll listen and be obedient to his word, because God wants to save you from all of the junk that the enemy has planned for you. And one of the biggest ways we do it is by what we look at, what we see. Movies. We've all gone to a movie, right? We've all seen a movie. It's hard-pressed to see a movie that doesn't have a couple making out or let alone doing more things, right? It's your choice. Are you going to watch it? Are you going to look at it? Or are you going to turn your eyes and not look? My husband and I, still, we do not watch kissing scenes. We do not watch making out scenes. Even in a regular, you know, now they're like PG-13 movies, it's happening. We don't watch it. We look at each other. Why? Because even though we're married, we still have to be pure. Purity is not just not having sex until I'm married. Purity is a state of our heart and our heart toward honoring God. So it's not just about not being sexual. It's about having a pure heart towards God and honoring him with all that we do. Okay, so our eyes. Ladies, sometimes, I mean, probably not any of you, but sometimes ladies really like reading romance novels. They like watching stories that are really romantic and watching the romantic movies. And, oh, it's a love story. Ah, my eyes fell. But you have to be careful of that, because sometimes what those things can do is they can open up your heart to something that is not godly and not holy. And so you really have to be careful of the things you're watching. I know when I was seventh grade, I'd watched Harry and the Hendersons when I was like 8. Very old movie, probably none of you know, but it was like about this monkey, like Sasquatch. that scared me really bad. And so I had a lot of fear that, praise the Lord, I got delivered from fear, but like for real, like real fear. So I never watched any scary movies. I never watched horror films, never, ever, ever like that. I hated scary things because I was always so scared when I was younger. Well, seventh grade, it was maybe seventh grade or eighth grade, which my mom very rarely let me go to anybody's house, but she let me go over to my friend's house this one time, which she was very justified in being wise and not letting me, but for some reason she let me this time. I don't know. So I went over to my friend's house and we were watching Cinderella. Anybody ever lied to your mom about what you were watching? Well, we didn't watch Cinderella. We watched Hannibal, which is a very bad movie. Very, very bad. And I was literally like under the covers, like super scary, like horror movie. And do not go watch it. It's bad. Well, now it's probably really dumb and old. But and I remember like having the blankets up over and I was shaking and like I was so scared. Like this like killer movie, okay? To give it context. And that night I went home and I, seventh, eighth grade, okay? I was your age. And I was so, I knew I had sinned. I knew I had done something I shouldn't have done. I knew I shouldn't have watched that. And all I could see, every time I closed my eyes, all I could see with those nails in the whale, oh, it was so gross. It was nasty. And like this girl died, you know, like it's just gross stuff. And you know how that is when we watch stuff, how you're away from it and you close your eyes and immediately you can see it? That's because that's the devil. He likes to bring things back up to our memory, things that we've seen, things that we've watched, and he flashes it before our eyes. Maybe you have looked at pornography and you're trying to worship love so deep, it washes, oh, and you're seeing, you know, somebody naked flash up in front of your eyes while you're trying to worship God. Why? Because that's the devil. He loves to play tricks on us. And so if we're wise, we won't look at those things. So then if you don't look at them, there's no popping up of them. It's a really easy way to save yourself from fear, from guilt, from sin. And so that night, I literally was crying myself to sleep. I was crying. My mom came in. She's like, what's wrong? And of course, I had to repent and like tell her what I did because I wouldn't be crying because I watched Cinderella. Right? Sometimes these young people were kind of stupid. We think that we can lie and get away with it. We think we can sin, it'll be okay. But the truth is that sin is always found out, whether it's today, tomorrow, or 5 years from now. Sin is always found out. And young people, we need to strive to live lives that are holy towards God because this whole world is like crazy. The world is crazy, but God has chosen us to live in this day, in this time, in this hour, to live holy and pure towards him. Okay, so eyes, that's one thing. All right, the next thing, ears. Ears, what you listen to. What are you listening to? Proverbs chapter 4, it's the scripture we read at the beginning of this message. So Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20. I'm going to read this out of the message. So it says a little bit differently. It says, my friends, listen well to my words. What are we to be listening to? God's words. Listen well to my words. Tune your ears to my voice. Tune your ears to God's voice. When all we do is watch TV and play video games, guess who we're tuning our ear to? TV and video games. If you don't read your Bible and you don't spend time with God, it is impossible for you to hear God's voice clearly. You have to spend time with God in order to hear him speaking. Keep my message in plain view at all times. That means read your Bible. Concentrate. Learn it by heart. Those who discover these words live, really live, body and soul. They're bursting with health. Verse 23 says, keep vigilant watch over your heart. That's where life starts. So what are we listening to? What kind of music are you listening to? Okay, so these are the practical things that you can do to live pure in this sexually driven world. If you go on iTunes and you pull up the latest song that Katy Perry wrote, I can't guarantee you that it's going to be honoring God. If you pull up the latest song that, you know, whatever rapper wrote, I can't guarantee that it's going to be encouraging your spirit towards the things of God. You have to be careful the things you're listening to. Okay, so that goes for explicit lyrics. You should not be listening to songs with explicit lyrics. That goes for love songs. I know. You think it's so cute to be singing all the love songs. Guess what, young person? You're not ready to be married yet. So you have no business listening to love songs. All it does is spur up stuff in your heart that you're not ready for. And you want to be cool and you want to be like everyone else because that's like the cool thing to do. But the truth is cool is dumb. Most of the time, cool is dumb. And the people who you think are cool, they're not honoring God with their lives. And they're not doing what God has called them to do. So in the end, they're not going to be where God wants them to be. And so sometimes you have to look maybe a little bit different than the rest of the people, do things different than the rest of the people at school are doing in order for you to honor God. When you're walking down the hall and your friends are gabbing and somebody's sharing a dirty joke, do you listen? Do you sit and wait for the punchline and laugh? Or do you walk away? These are choices that we have every single day, young person. You have control over the music you listen to. Now, I'm not talking if you go into a store and a song is playing. Obviously, you can walk out of the store, but you don't have control over the music they play, but you have the control over the music that you listen to for yourself. Choose wisely. Bible says in Proverbs chapter 4 that we're to listen to the voice of God. So that means don't listen to the enemy. You know, the devil wants to lie to you. He wants to tell you you're dumb, you're not good enough, you can never do it. You can never stay pure, it's impossible. Everyone's having sex, you should too. No, you don't have to listen to the lies of the enemy. That is the devil trying to lie to you and trick you, just like he tricked Eve. He said, ooh, look at this apple. Ooh, don't you think it's gonna taste amazing? And that's what he does with you. He brings some cute boy or some cute girl along like, oh, isn't she cute? Come on, just hold her hand. Just a little kiss, it's okay. The devil's sly, he's tricky. And if you're not careful, you'll fall in the trap and then you'll be going, oh no, I sinned, I did it. The good news is there's grace and mercy. So if you've already crossed those lines, God is more than gracious and more than loving and more than forgiving to pick you up and start again. Guess what? There is purity after sex. So if you've already messed up, there's still purity for you. All you have to do is run back to Jesus and say, according to 1 John 1:9, Lord, I'm sorry, I sinned. Call it for what it is. I sinned. Forgive me. And you know what he says? He forgives and forgets. And you can start fresh and make a determination in your heart. It might be a little bit harder, but you can do it. It's possible to make a fresh start and say, okay, God, no, I'm going to be pure. I'm going to live pure. Because it's not just in having sex. Like I said, it's in our hearts. Purity is a state of our hearts and how we live towards God. All right, next one. Mouth. Our mouth. What words are coming out of your mouth? Are they words of purity and honor and blessing towards God? Or is every other word a cuss word when you're at school? I did that when I was in my sinning days of junior high. I lived one life at school and I lived another life at home and at church. And my parents thought I was very holy and pure. But at school, I'm telling you, I was somebody completely different because I let the world dictate who I was. And it's funny how you can control your mouth when you're around certain people, isn't it? I never once cussed in front of my parents. Never once did a cuss word slip out. But at school, ooh, yeah, all the time I was cussing because I thought it was cool. Remember, cool is dumb. Cool is dumb. Your mouth, what words are coming out of your mouth? Matthew 15, verse 11 says, what truly contaminates a person is not what he puts into his mouth, but what comes out of his mouth. So in the Old Testament, just to give you a little bit of background here, in the Old Testament, they had all these laws and rules, like you can't eat pig, you can't eat rabbit because it chews cud and it has a hoof a certain way. And like they had to be super careful of what kind of foods they ate. So they were super under rules and regulations and they were very picky about the food they ate. But they didn't really live very holy because it was all about the rules and the regulations. So in their heart, they were nasty, but on the outside, they were doing all the right things to look good. And sometimes as Christians, we still do that today. Okay, but what this verse says is what you put into your mouth, so what you eat isn't defiling you. And this is Jesus talking. He says, what comes out of your mouth, the words that come out of your mouth is what defiles you. And verse 18, it says, but what comes out of your mouth reveals the core of your heart. The words can pollute, not food. You will find living with an impure heart, there abides evil ideas, murderous thoughts, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, lies, and slander. So out of an impure heart, our mouth speaks impurities. Out of a pure heart comes good things. What pollutes a person, that's what pollutes a person. So what are the kind of things that you're talking about? When you're gabbing on or texting with your friend, okay, it's technically not your mouth, it's your fingers moving, but nowadays that's how you communicate, right? When you're Snapchatting somebody, what is coming out of your thought process? What's coming out of your mouth? What is the self-talk when you look in the mirror? What's coming out of your mouth? What's going through your brain? Those things are important, young people. And the Bible talks a whole lot about, in Proverbs, about lying and all of that kind of stuff, which we're not going to go into. But the truth is that when we have dirty talk, when we have a lot of cussing, when we have that kind of things, then our heart isn't pure. Because the Bible says, "What out of the abundance of our heart, our mouth speaks." And so the Bible says, put a guard over your mouth. Stop yourself from saying those things. Don't be telling dirty jokes. Don't be saying vulgar things. Don't let cuss words come out of your mouth. Make a determination. No, I'm going to live purely and wholly towards God. And that's going to show not just in the things that I look at, not just in the things that I listen to, but also in what is coming out of my mouth. When I hang out with my friends at school, they're going to know that I'm different because I don't talk the way they talk. Because I read my Bible and that's what comes out of me. I spend time in the Word and that's what is coming out. I might accidentally tell someone, praise God, because I've spent time in God's presence. Okay, I'm also going to mention this too. Sometimes, maybe if you've had a boyfriend or a girlfriend, some of you guys waved your hand on that answer earlier, but sometimes we even tell our boyfriend or girlfriend we love them prematurely. And I would venture to say that that is not godly. Because the truth is, if you're not ready to get married, you probably shouldn't be telling somebody you love them in that way. Because when you do that, you're giving them a piece of your heart. You're giving them a piece of you. And you have to be careful. You better be, if you're close to 18, then those are the ages that you should be even starting to think about marrying somebody. If you're 14, if you're 11, if you're 16, it's too young. Just try and find a friend and be friends with people. You don't have to have a boyfriend or girlfriend. Remember, cool is dumb. Everybody say it with me. Cool is dumb. Okay, you need to think that way because what you think is cool, the cool couple who, oh my gosh, you know, prom queen and prom king, oh, they're not cool. That's not cool. That's not holy. That's not pure. And so what you see at school doesn't mean that it's holy or pure or godly. That's why we have to look to the Word of God. Okay, hands. Yes, hands. It matters where your hands go. Can I hear an amen to that? It matters what you do with your hands. You can do a lot of things with your hands. You can use them to praise the Lord, or you can use them to do things that are not good. Okay? I'm telling you, yeah, get your praise hands up, y'all. Okay, Matthew chapter 5, verse 30 says, if your right hand, which this is the same scripture where if your eye sins, pluck it out. If your right hand sins, if you're touching what you're not supposed to touch, if you're scrolling and poking on the wrong things on your phone that you shouldn't be poking at, the Bible says, cut off your hand. You'd be better without your hand than to go to hell. If I had an altar call for who wants to go to hell, how many of you guys would come up here? Sin, fire, gnashing of teeth, eternal damnation. Who wants it? It doesn't sound very enticing, does it? No, none of you guys would come up here if I had an altar call for who wants to go to hell. Why? Because we don't want to go to hell. We want to go to heaven. But sometimes the desires in our heart lead us to hell. And that's why it's important to pay attention to the things we're doing and seeing and talking about. Okay, next one, mind. Are you guys ready for this? It's a brain, your mind. You know what matters? What you're thinking about. It matters what your mind is thinking about. I'm not a ventriloquist, but yes, it matters. It matters what you're thinking about. You know that from when you're a young age, these little grooves, okay, like they don't really look like this, but these little grooves, the thought patterns that you have ingrain grooves on your brain, and the more you think a certain way, the easier it is to think that way. That's why it's important to read your Bible. Okay, so your mind, what are you thinking about? What are you stressed out about? What are you daydreaming about? What are you fantasizing about? Ladies, gentlemen, we shouldn't be thinking about things that are impure and ungodly. Because if we're thinking about those kind of things, guess where you're going to be leading to? To those things that are ungodly. That's what happens. The more you think about it, the next thing you find, if you're thinking about eating ice cream, you're sitting here, oh, I just need some ice cream. This is my husband. He eats ice cream all the time. He's like, oh, I just need ice cream. If you're thinking about ice cream, the next thing you're going to be doing is going to your freezer and looking for the ice cream. Why? Because when you think about something, when you dwell on something, you want it and you crave it even more. So be careful the things you're setting your mind on. Philippians 4 says, set your mind on the things which are holy and pure and good and of a good report. Okay? What are you thinking about? What are you fantasizing about? Don't fantasize. All right, last one. Your heart. You know what matters? Where you set the affections of your heart. Like for real. If you're setting the affections of your heart on the cute guy in school or that hot smoking girl that you think is so hot and so cute, then you're setting your heart affections on the wrong things. Did you hear me? Proverbs chapter 4, where we started, says this in the Passion Translation, my favorite. It says, so above all, guard the affections of your heart. Guard the affections of your heart. That includes your thoughts, your will, your discernment, and your affections. For they affect all that you are. Everything that you do comes from out of your heart. It's so important that you guard your heart. What are you letting into your heart through your eyes and your ears? What are you letting take place in your heart? What are you setting your affections on? Have you made up your mind and your heart to stay pure? Have you made a determination in your heart that I'm going to save myself for my spouse? I encourage you, make up that determination in your heart. I am going to stay pure because God has asked me to. We read it at the beginning. God has asked us to stay sexually pure. And he's very clear. He wasn't like, stay kind of pure or maybe mess around a little bit and then might be okay. No, he was very clear about what sexual immorality is. And that is sin. It's having sex outside of marriage. It's making out. It's crossing those boundaries. And young people, I'm telling you, it might look weird to the outside world. What? You don't have a boyfriend? You're weird. Oh, you don't have a girlfriend? What's wrong with you? You don't, what? You've never kissed anyone? Oh. People might make fun of you. But guess what, young person? I would rather go to heaven and be made fun of than go to hell and be all the cool people. Cool is dumb. Cool is dumb. All the things that we think is cool is not cool in God's eyes. God's called us to live a holy and pure life. If you're in a relationship right now, have you made up boundaries in your heart of things you will not do and lines you will not cross? Like, I'm going to keep my clothes on. That's a good boundary to have. I'm not going to be alone with somebody of the opposite sex. That's a good boundary to have. And if you haven't made up your heart and your mind of things that you will and will not do, then when the cute guy comes, when the cute girl comes, it's easy to slip into it and fall into it because that's what everyone else is doing. It's what we see everywhere. And so you have to make up your heart and your mind of what you will and will not do before the situation arises. The Bible says that God always leaves a way of escape. He always makes a way of escape. Meaning if you get yourself into a situation that you know you shouldn't be there, God makes a way where you can get out of it. But you have to do the getting out. You have to run. You have control over your feet. You have control over your eyes, your ears, your mouth, your thoughts. You have control over your mind. You have control over your heart and where you set your affections. Choose carefully. Choose wisely, young person. Don't just give your heart away to everyone. Make up your mind what your boundaries are gonna be. I'm not gonna hold hands with somebody that I'm not married to. I'm not gonna lay on the couch and make out with someone. Even if your parents say that it's okay. Why? Because God said it's sin. God said when we give our hearts away outside of marriage, it's sin. 1 John 1:9 in the New Living Translation says it like this. If we claim to have no sin, we're only fooling ourselves. So that's like you saying, oh, holding hands isn't that bad. Oh, making out, that's not really sin. I'm still a virgin. I haven't had sex yet. If we do that, we're only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. But if we confess our sins to Him, if you're open and honest with God, then He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. For if we claim we have not sinned, we're calling God a liar and showing that His words have no place in our hearts. I don't know about you, but I don't want to call God a liar. I don't want to say, God, you have no place in my heart. No, no, no. I'm setting my affections on the Lord. I've chosen. I'm going to stay pure. Even in marriage, I'm going to keep my heart pure. I'm going to keep my eyes pure. I'm not going to look at things I'm not supposed to look at. I'm not going to listen to things that I'm not supposed to listen to. I'm not going to set my affections on someone else other than my spouse. You know, there's still purity that has to take place once you get married. It doesn't stop just because you get married. Because purity isn't just what you do with your body, it's your heart. Everybody stand up with me. We're gonna take just a couple minutes here. I really feel like some of us, maybe you're in that place where you've already crossed the lines. Maybe you were like me when I was a teenager. I was already doing stuff I shouldn't have been doing. I felt so guilty, I felt so bad. Tonight's your night to say, okay, God, I'm going to use 1 John 1:9. I'm going to really repent of this sin. I'm going to call it what it is. It's sin. Maybe you've been cussing. Maybe you've been messing around with somebody of the opposite sex. Maybe you've been doing stuff that you shouldn't be doing. Maybe you've been looking at pornography. Maybe you've been messing around with listening to bad music. Whatever it is that God, the Holy Spirit, is convicting you of. Tonight's your night where you can make a choice. No, I'm going to repent. Because I want to live pure and holy towards God. Because God has commanded it of me. He's asked it of me. God is asking you, young person, tonight, will you live pure? Will you live holy? Will you live for me? Maybe some of you guys have never made up your mind that I'm going to keep myself pure. Maybe you haven't done all the junk yet. That's awesome. Like high fives all around. But you still have your whole life ahead of you. And you need to make a determination in your heart that, no, I'm going to stay pure. I'm going to live pure. I'm not ever going to get into pornography. I'm not ever going to look at something that I shouldn't be looking at. Anytime any of that junk pops up, I'm going to immediately scroll away because I've made my heart up and my mind up that I'm not going to give myself over to that stuff. I'm going to stay a virgin until I get married. I'm going to save myself for my spouse. Every head bowed, eyes closed. Come on, God's speaking to you right now. Maybe you were the first one. Maybe you were the second one. It doesn't really matter where you lie in any of those things. The truth is that God's dealing with your heart right now if you're sensitive and if you're listening. And He wants a response. He's requiring a response to us. And that response is, yes, God, I see that your word says that I should live pure. And God, I want to do that. I want to do that, God. If that's you, if you want to make that determination tonight, maybe it's for the first time, maybe it's a renewal, maybe you've already messed up and you want to say, God, I want to come back. I want to truly repent of the sin that I've done. If you've already repented, then it's already under the blood. You don't have to repent again. But if you haven't, then I encourage you, true repentance is turning away from that. If that's any of you, any of those things apply to you, just lift your hand in the air. Everybody's eyes closed, no looking around. Come on, God wants to minister to you. Right now, under your breath, you tell him if you need to repent, if you need to make that determination in your heart. I'm just going to give you a few seconds here. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. This is between you and God. You're the only one who can control your heart's emotions. Thank you, Father. God, I just thank you for your strength tonight, for these young people that have made a determination to live pure towards you. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, make that determination right now. God, I'm going to live pure. I'm going to save myself. Or if you need to repent, do that now. Between you and God, this is between you and God. Thank you, Lord. Every hand lifted. Father, I pray a blessing over these young people. God, that you would help them, strengthen them by your Spirit, that the things that they look at would be pure and holy, the things that they listen to, the things that they do with their hands and their bodies and that where their feet take them, what their mind thinks upon. Lord, I ask that you would help them by the help of the Holy Spirit to make the right choices, to control themselves against all the lust of the flesh. Lord, that in you, anything is possible when we believe. And God, it is possible to stay pure. And I ask that you would help these young people to do it unto you, God, a living sacrifice to you, Lord. We give you the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen. Amen. If you made that determination tonight, I encourage you, go talk to a leader about it. Talk to your parents about it. Tell them the decision that you made. If you've been messing around and doing things you shouldn't have been doing, maybe God's asking you to confess it to your parents. It's powerful when you can come clean, not because you got caught. That's true repentance. So I encourage you, listen to the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. Amen. Let's live pure. All right. Love you guys. Have an awesome night.